Thank you. The next item of business. The next item of business is a debate on motion 13005 in the name of Anna Sarwar on motion of no confidence, and I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Anna Sarwar to speak to and move the motion. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by recognising the significant announcement Hamza Yousaf made this week that he was resigning as First Minister? While he and I have significant political disagreements, I think it's important to take a moment to thank him for his public service, which has included 12 years as a minister, and I wish him and his family the very best for the future. But for me and Scottish Labour, this has never been about one person. It is also not just about the past 17 years of SNP failure, but even more significantly, it is about the present and the future. Now more than ever, our country needs credible and effective leadership and stable and competent government to take on the twin crises facing our nation, an economic crisis and an NHS crisis. And I have no confidence in the SNP's ability to deliver that, and that is why I am bringing this motion to Parliament today. And this motion of no confidence in this SNP government is based on two principal arguments. First, it is now clear that the SNP as a political party are so chaotic, divided and dysfunctional that it can't deliver competent government and is failing Scots every single day. And I don't believe that changes if they purely change the face at the top. Let's look at the two candidates being suggested, Kate Forbes and John Swinney. There are already SNP ministers briefing journalists that if Kate Forbes was to become leader, they would actively look to stop her being able to form a government, and that would mean even more chaos. And John Swinney, the man who has been at the heart of the SNP government for the last 17 years, the heart of the SNP leadership for the last 40 years, the finance secretary that broke the public finances, and the worst education secretary in the history of the Scottish Parliament. Hardly the competence or the change our country needs. And second, it is about the democratic deficit. It would be untenable for the SNP to impose yet another unelected First Minister on our country, especially in these circumstances.
Let me remind the Chamber
what Nicola Sturgeon said when Rishi Sunak replaced Liz Truss as Prime Minister. She said we couldn't have a revolving door at Downing Street, that the office of Prime Minister was not the plaything of one political party, and that there would be a democratic outrage if it didn't go to an election and for the people to decide. If that's the principle the SNP rightly apply to Westminster and the UK, why do they now hold Scotland and this Parliament to a lower standard? Now, I know SNP members will point to Vaughan Gething as First Minister in Wales or other examples, but it's important to recognise the difference. Leaders stating that they would not complete full terms or leaving due to deeply personal circumstances and having a managed and orderly transition is very different from two leaders leaving in controversy and chaos. Because for the second time in as many years, we have scandal, incompetence and political self-interest, with the SNP putting party before country and imposing their choice on the people of Scotland. Because it should be for the people to decide who leads our country, not a backroom deal, not a stage-managed coronation or a small group of SNP members. And, Presiding Officer, I think the similarities now between the UK Conservative Government and the SNP Scottish Government are now so clear to see. Two political parties, both chaotic, divided, dysfunctional, unleadable, ungovernable, incompetent, distracted by internal wars, distant from the people's priorities and unable to fix the mess of their own making. Both looking to pitch community against community, both entrenched in the politics of division, and both unable to meet the ambitions, hopes and aspirations of the people. That's why our country is crying out for change. Yes, they want rid of this rotten Tory government across the UK, but they also want to move on from this dysfunctional and incompetent SNP government here in Scotland. That's why we need an election, so the people can decide. And it's getting clearer and clearer by the day that only Labour can deliver the change Scotland needs. And I can hear from SNP members that they don't agree, but it's because it's them that have stopped listening to the Scottish people. The people struggling in a cost of living crisis who need a government on their side, focused on jobs and lowering bills. The people languishing on NHS waiting lists who need a government that will renew and reform our NHS. The people stuck in temporary accommodation with record levels of homelessness who need a government focused on building new homes. The people who worry about their children's future who need a government to raise education standards and bring opportunities to every community. The people who can see the huge potential of Scotland being squandered by two incompetent governments and who need a government that actually believes in economic growth and is willing to work with business. It is now clearer than it's ever been that it's time for the people of Scotland to have their say. It's time to elect a government capable of delivering on the ambitions and hopes of every person in our great country. And that's why, Presiding Officer, I have no confidence in this SNP government. I have no confidence that they can deliver the stability and competence we need. That's why it's time for change, and I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. I now call the First Minister up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As this, of course, is my first opportunity to do so since my announcement on Monday, can I begin by putting on record my thanks to you, Presiding Officer, for the job that you have done throughout my tenure overseeing proceedings in this chamber. Presiding Officer, I'm afraid that with this First Minister shortly leaving government, you may have one more raucous backbencher to have to manage. But can I also thank Anas Sawar at the beginning of his remarks for his kind remarks. Can I thank actually everybody across the chamber, many who have sent me kind messages over the last 24 and 48 hours. I have to say, getting so many kind messages from the opposition has unnerved me ever so slightly. Nonetheless, let me concentrate on Anas Sawar's remarks. He did start his speech by saying, for Anas Sawar, this is not personal, then launched an attack on John Swinney and Kate Forbes. Yeah. Even by Anas Sawar standards, that is the fastest Labour U-turn, yeah. Presiding Officer, I think I have ever seen. And Anas Sawar also, throughout his speech, spoke about members of this Parliament being unelected. But let's be absolutely clear here. Every single member of this Scottish Parliament, SNP, Labour, Liberal Democrat, Conservatives, Greens, ALBA, they are all elected. Let's not cast any doubt upon that. When it comes to attacking my colleagues, John Swinney, and of course, Kate Forbes, let me remind Anas Sawar that, of course, when they put themselves up for the vote, when they put themselves up to the people's verdict in the constituencies that they stood for, they won, unlike Anas Sawar, presiding officer. Yep. So let's not talk about unelected versus elected. Everybody here is elected. Well, we know, of course, presiding officer, that the motion of no confidence today will be defeated. It does give me the opportunity to talk up our record and this government's considerable achievements, but also point out Labour's lack of substance, but also hypocrisy as well. And as I've found out, presiding officer, only too well in the last few days, politics is definitely about the choices we choose to make. And as a government, I am exceptionally proud of our choices. Where the Westminster consensus, Labour and Tories, have chosen Brexit, Scotland chose to remain in the EU. Mm-hmm. Rishi Sunak, Keir Starmer both chose to retain the two-child limit and the rape clause. Yeah. The SNP government opposes it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Labour chooses to lift the cap on bankers' bonuses, yep, but not lift the cap on child benefits. The SNP choose differently. Mm-hmm. And Sir Keir Starmer, who of course Anas Sawar answers to, chooses to commit to Tory spending and tax plans. Yeah. These plans mean the wealthy will benefit from a tax cut, while the NHS and other public services get slashed to the bone. Mm-hmm. We choose progressive taxation to increase investment in the NHS and public services. We choose to launch a 10-year just transition fund to support Scotland's drive to net zero, where, of course, Labour choose to ditch their £28 billion green energy pledge. And where Keir Starmer refused for months to call for an immediate ceasefire, even failing to condemn the collective punishment of the people of Gaza, I and the government I lead chose to be a voice for peace and humanity in the world. So yes, Presiding Officer, those are just some of the choices I and those in the seats behind me are so proud of. And what of the result of those choices? Attainment in Scotland at a record high. Record numbers of students from deprived areas entering our university. This year, this government's actions are lifting an estimated 100,000 children out of poverty. We continue to be the top destination for foreign investment outside of London. More people are coming to Scotland from the rest of the UK than leaving, and yet no one, but no one, and the opposition thinks about pausing for a second to ask why. Could it have something to do with the very choices this SNP government have made? Choices like the baby box, expanded childcare, free university education, free prescriptions, free nursing and personal care, free school meals, no bridge tolls, no hospital car parking charges, free bus travel for under 22s, those with a disability, those over 60, the game-changing Scottish child payment, and so much more. All because of the choices we have made, all because of our record. And all of that, Presiding Officer, in the face of 14 years of Tory austerity, a Brexit we didn't vote for, and a Westminster cost of living crisis we didn't create, but our people are suffering as a result of. So yes, I am proud of the record of the government that I have the honour of leading, at least for a little while longer. So, Presiding Officer, as I reflect on my time as First Minister coming to an end, I will remind the Chamber what I said when I first became First Minister. I promised my door would always be open. I promised that I would listen to good ideas that came from across the parliamentary chamber. And I have to say, in that whole time, the 13 months that I've been blessed, lucky to be First Minister, I haven't heard a single positive idea from Anas Sawar or the Labour idea. That's clear from this afternoon's debate. What I have heard, however, is the deafening sound of principle after principle being thrown out of Anas Sawar's window. You turning on the two-child cap, you turning on the devolution of employment law, you turning on the devolution of drug law, you turning on his support for WASP women. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we on the SNP benches here will leave Labour to justify all of that if they can. We will never do anything other than stand by our values, stand by Scotland's values. The true vote of no confidence that the people of Scotland really need and they deserve is a vote of no confidence in this failing, miserable union that is holding Scotland back and inflicting damage on the people and the economy of this country. The cosy Westminster Alliance represented here today are terrified of such a vote. Why? Because they know what the result will be. So I urge the Chamber, Presiding Officer, to reject this motion and let's start focusing on the real priorities of the people of Scotland.
Thank you. Thank you. I now call on Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And on a personal level, can I wish Hamza Yousaf well as he prepares to leave office? I think it's been clear that I have disagreed with many of the policies he has introduced in his time. But he has served our country as First Minister for a year and in government for over a decade. And it's also been very clear during his time in office, and particularly during his resignation statement on Monday, that family is important to him. It is integral to everything he does. And while he will have reflections and I'm sure regrets over the coming months and years, I know he will take comfort in being able to spend more time with the family he cherishes and one that is going to get bigger in a few months' time. So we wish him well for that as well. But, Presiding Officer, Scottish Conservatives will vote in favour of the motion today. We want to see the SNP government removed and will look to use every opportunity to do so. Yet Labour have failed to build the majority they need in this Parliament to achieve that. In contrast, my party's vote of no confidence in Hamza Yousaf was successful. Hamza Yousaf has announced he is resigning from the office of of First Minister, and it was the Scottish Conservatives who built a parliamentary majority to force him out.
Yep.
That's what strong opposition can deliver, and that is just the first step. We want to get rid of this entire distracted, divided SNP government. And the upcoming general election will have a chance to deliver another blow to them. In seats across Scotland, it's only the Scottish Conservatives who can get rid of the SNP, just like we're getting rid of Hamza Yousaf, and get the focus back onto the priorities of people right across this country. But as we look ahead to the interim period, where we are now, the would-be successors to Hamza Yousaf are hardly rushing out the blocks to seize that poison chalice to lead the SNP. But two names are being mentioned to take over. And it's interesting, both are creeping a little further to the front bench and are ideally placed for us today, one behind the other, so I'm sure the cameras will get a great shot of them. But it looks as though Nicola Sturgeon's health secretary will either be replaced by Nicola Sturgeon's deputy or Nicola Sturgeon's finance secretary. And what does this say about the current Scottish government?
Yep.
Each of the individuals on the front bench today, handpicked by Hamza Yousaf to run departments of this government, have ruled themselves out. They don't want to do it. Never mind the opposition having no confidence in this government, it seems none of the government ministers have confidence in themselves. But the front runners, though, represent continuity. Kate Forbes ran Scotland's economy when it lagged behind the rest of the United Kingdom. Her budgets put up taxes on Scottish workers and failed to pass on vital relief to Scottish businesses.
Yep.
And Kate Forbes has said she wants to hold an independence referendum within 3 months of a general election. She's an even more radical nationalist than Hamza Yousaf and Nicola Sturgeon. Then, Presiding Officer, there's Honest John. If he's successful, Scotland faces
Mr Ross, we do not use nicknames in the chamber.
Oh, sorry, I thought it was on accuracy, because it would be not so Honest John with some of the things we've heard
Mr.
recently.
Mr Ross, I would ask you to apologise and then continue.
But then there's...
No, Mr Ross, if you might apologise and then continue.
Yes. Then there's John Swinney.
Mr Ross, you may not be able to hear me. I'd be grateful if you would apologise for that and then continue.
I will apologise. I'm very sorry for any hurt caused. But if John Swinney is successful, we face the dreadful prospect of Nicola Sturgeon's prodigy being replaced by Nicola Sturgeon's right-hand man. Of going from the man who ruined Scotland's NHS to the man who ruined Scotland's education system. Of going from one failed leader to a leader who has already failed. Whichever nationalist wins, we already know they'll obsess about independence. We will remain the highest tax part of the United Kingdom for workers and businesses. 1 in 7 Scots will remain on an NHS waiting list. Scottish education will continue to fall down international rankings. Duelling key roads like the A9 and the A96 will continue to be delayed. Police numbers will continue to drop and dangerous criminals will be let off with reduced sentences. Whether we have a bitter battle or a cosy coronation to elect the next leader of the SNP, they will continue campaigning for independence and the Scottish people will continue to be failed by them.
Thank you. I now call on Patrick Harvey.
As I've already said to the First Minister personally, the events of the last week are a source of regret, but certainly not of hostility or ill will at a personal level, and it is appropriate today to acknowledge the human impact of political life. For Hamza Yousaf, that impact was shown most clearly in a moment of immense dignity when at a time of when global political events were impacting directly on his own family. Hamza Yousaf rightly gained huge respect for speaking out for, and in many cases humanising, the people of Gaza. humanising the victims of collective punishment in a way that no other national leader I can think of was able to do. For this and for a great deal more, Hamza Yousaf is due respect and thanks. And all of our thanks for his service to the country. Now, others may have a very long list of grievances. They may have an implacable hostility to everything the First Minister or the SNP or the Bute House Agreement represents. But for the Greens, the reason we were unable to have confidence in the First Minister personally was his decision to needlessly end the progressive, pro-independence majority government. It is to his credit that he's taken personal responsibility and announced his resignation. I don't celebrate that in any way, but I do believe it was necessary. And in the light of that decision, a vote of no confidence in the First Minister personally would have been performative and petty, and I welcome the fact that it's been withdrawn. But a vote of no confidence in the Scottish Government as a whole, this proposal betrays the true motives of others. Chaos for the sake of chaos. Let's just consider what would happen if it passed. Let's just consider what would happen if it passed. A month to seek another government, then an election around the time that voters around the country were heading off on their summer holidays, a new government formed perhaps by August, leaving, if members will permit another viewpoint to be heard, leaving just a little more than a year and a half until the legally required dissolution for the 2026 election. And in that time, what would happen to the legislation that's urgently needed? A housing bill's just been introduced with measures on homelessness prevention and long-term rent controls. We've a need for a climate reset following the admission that Scotland is years behind where we should be on emission cuts. Or one of the few areas of climate policy that's been praised in the last couple of years, the Heat in Buildings programme, which needs legislation soon if it's going to be completed in time to accelerate the emission cuts from a previously neglected sector. All of this and much, much more would be delayed. And then after less than 2 years, yet another government, potentially with a different policy agenda altogether. Presiding officer, fixed-term parliaments are intended to give stability, and they have done so in contrast with more than a decade of chaos in Westminster politics. It should be clear to everyone that both Labour and the Conservatives don't actually want stable self-government for Scotland. Greens do. Now, we already had the best option, a stable, progressive, pro-independence majority government, and I regret that it hasn't been allowed to continue. The government will no longer be a majority government. But minority government can work. It's happened before, and it can happen again. It's not beyond the ability of any political party in this chamber to work constructively in that context, if they choose to. But a minority government must reach out and bring together a majority in Parliament. And for that to happen, it will need to remain a progressive government. A reset on climate, an acceleration of emission cuts, not defeatism. A bold commitment to equality, not a shabby compromise with a nasty, divisive culture war mentality that we see from elsewhere. And continued redistribution, which will be all the more important if an incoming UK Labour government carries out its threat to stick to Tory fiscal rules, meaning even more austerity. That's the progressive agenda, which is still capable of providing stable government for Scotland instead of the chaos that the Labour motion seeks.
Thank you. And I now call on Willie Rennie.
Politics can be ugly, and never more so than the last week. But I have to pay great tribute to the First Minister, for I thought in a moment of great stress that he made a speech of great dignity and grace. It was a resignation speech, I think, if we were all in those situations, that we would want to make, and I think it's a great tribute to him. And personally, I've always found him a very warm and generous individual with a great smile and a sense of humour. And I do congratulate him and Nadia for the soon-to-be parents. Again, if he thought he was going to escape the sleepless nights, I think they're about to come back with a vengeance. But it does say something that the leadership of the Conservative Party is more stable than the leadership of the SNP. Now, I'm old enough to remember when Nicola Sturgeon was First Minister, and it's good to see her back in her place this afternoon. And I don't know whether she would want to make an intervention on the contribution that she made before when she said the governance of any country cannot simply be a revolving door, that one party gets to pick time and time again who occupies the highest office in the land. Now, I don't know if she resiles from those remarks, but I'm sure the Chamber this afternoon would welcome her updated commentary on whether there should be an election now, because that's something that I think is worth considering, and that's why we'll support the motion of no confidence this afternoon. I notice she's not rising to her feet. I suspect she's ducking this one quite smartly. But this government is fond, and this is my second reason for supporting the vote this afternoon. This government is fond of saying that it's the best in the UK. Now, the best, I don't think, is how you could judge the view of the single mother in my constituency who went without food in order to pay for her private dental bills because she couldn't get an NHS dentist. Or the elderly man I met who was wincing with pain because his operation had been delayed once again for his hip operation. Or the classroom assistant who had a broken wrist right in front of me because she had a violent incident with a pupil in a class. Or the islanders who are desperately waiting for a reliable ferry service. They're not saying that this is the best, but this government is riddled with complacency. It believes that somehow, because we're marginally better on some occasions than the Conservative government, that somehow we should be grateful for the performance of this government. And I think that is the second reason why we need a renewed mandate for this parliament, and that's why we should have an election. Now, Jamie Hepburn, I'm a big fan of Jamie Hepburn. Many people have heard me talk about Jamie Hepburn before. He toils away on his own in private with his civil servants, crafting document after document that absolutely nobody reads, but nevertheless, we've got to give him credit for that. Now, I want to release Jamie Hepburn for the endless torture of this responsibility. For that reason alone, I'm sure everybody would agree that we should have an election. But I never thought I would ever say the words that I agree with Ash Regan. But her comments earlier on, where she said, we chucked the Greens out the front door to sneak them in the back door, is the fundamental problem with this government. Because either it heals the rift with the Green Party, or it heals the rift with the public. And it can't do both. That was Humza Yousaf's view last week, that the Bute House Agreement couldn't continue, that it was dragging down the SNP, so therefore we needed to have that break. No, but they need the majority, and that's why they need the Greens. So it's not possible to have a mandate in this parliament, and therefore it needs to be renewed. And for all of those reasons, for the revolving door, for the belief that it's the best, for the case of Jamie Hepburn, if nothing else, but also to heal the rift, we need to have an election.
Thank you, and I call on Jackie Bailey to wind up.
Presiding Officer, I used to think that there really isn't anything that was new in politics, but I have to say that the current period of chaotic government is exceptional, whether it's at Westminster or indeed at Holyrood. We've had a ringside seat observing the trauma experienced by the current UK government. First it was Boris Johnson, but Partygate was his undoing. Then we had Liz Truss for all of 50 days, and that resulted in interest rates rising and mortgages spiralling out of control. And now, of course, we have Rishi Sunak presiding over the country's continuing decline. The last two, of course, were appointed by the Tory party and were not elected by the country. And the parallels with the current SNP government are self-evident. With the SNP, we are about to have a third leader in as many years. The last two elected by their party and not by our country. And I think the people of Scotland deserve to be heard. And I'm not alone in that thinking. Here's what others had to say when Rishi Sunak was elected. It shouldn't just be down to Tory MPs and Tory members to pick the next Prime Minister. Ian Blackford, 22nd of October 2022. Then we have this comment. He should call an early general election. He's the second person in a row to be appointed as Prime Minister by the Tories, not elected by the population. The idea that he can go for 2 years before seeking or winning a democratic mandate, I think, is just unthinkable. Nicola Sturgeon, 24th of October, 2022. So, it's unthinkable. Is Nicola Sturgeon now wrong? So given that we face exactly the same situation in Scotland, the SNP should at least be consistent and agree that democracy demands a Holyrood election. But what have they got to fear? Are they worried about the verdict of the people of Scotland? Their verdict on 1 in 6 people on NHS waiting lists. Their verdict, not one of the SNP's targets to end long waits have been met. A 10% increase in drug deaths, 10,000 people waiting on social care assessments and support, an economy that is weak, struggling to gain traction, and growth is stagnant. Funding for colleges and universities slashed, affecting the very future of our young people. Yeah. Homelessness applications increasing, rough sleeping back on our streets, and a record high for the number of households, particularly with children, in temporary accommodation. A housing emergency, presiding officer, but the SNP slashed the housing budget by £190 million. And of course, climate targets weakened and scrapped. This is a record of shame. It's a record of failure. People are tired of two governments that are failing them. They want change. They want a government focused on their priorities, on the NHS, on the economy, on education. But instead, we will have another SNP contest for the next First Minister. More division, more acrimony, more anonymous briefings from Cabinet Secretaries, but zero focus on the things that matter to the people of Scotland. It's time for a Holyrood election. It's time for change.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on motion of no confidence. We'll now move to the question on the motion. And the question is that motion 13005 in the name of Anna Sarwar on motion of no confidence be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.